Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us. My name is Jasmine Jordan, and I serve as the chairwoman of the University of Iowa chapter of Young Americans for Freedom. Iowa YAF is the premier conservative organization on campus, promoting conservative and traditional values. We exhibit these essential principles through activism projects like the 9/11 Never Forget Memorial, Freedom Week, the Stand Up for Israel Memorial, When Does Life Begin Timeline, Detransitioner Visibility Tabling, and tonight's guest speaker. Thanks to our dedicated efforts in collaborating with these initiatives and guest speakers, we are honored to be recognized as the recipient of the Chapter of the Year Award. If you're interested in learning more about what we do, I recommend that you attend our weekly Monday meetings and reach out to us via Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at @Iowa_YAF. As we prepare to introduce our esteemed guest, I want to extend a heartfelt thanks to the volunteers and YAF members who generously contributed their time and effort to make this event a success. Additionally, I'd like to express our gratitude to our national organization, Young Americans Foundation, for their unfaltering support. As with all of our events, since the first day of advertising, our posters have been torn down throughout campus and downtown Iowa City. Our chalk advertisements have been washed away, and our new promotional banner was torn down, stomped on, and thrown away in the trash multiple times. But these petty thieves' demise, we have and will continue to prevail. I'm grateful for the presence of a chapter that upholds unwavering principles, shows unyielding determination, and demonstrates enduring commitment. With great excitement, I introduce Paula Scanlan, who serves as the Stand With Women spokeswoman and advisor for both Independent Women's Forum and Independent Women's Voice, and aims to advocate the joint mission of defending women's single-sex spaces and championing the right to free speech. Scanlan graduated from the University of Pennsylvania, where she was a member of the women's swim team. Inspired by fellow female athletes, Paula broke her silence in June 2023 on her experience as a teammate of William Lia Thomas, as the efforts of her college's administration and student body to silence her and suppress her right to free speech. Scanlan has encouraged females, especially athletes, to come forward, share their stories, and join her in making change to protect women everywhere. Let's give a very warm Hawkeye welcome to Paula Scanlan.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. Hold on. Okay. So first off, I know a lot of you guys probably wish you were at a basketball game right now. And obviously, hold on, I'm going to see if I can get this out. So obviously, women's sports are very important. And I would just like to point out that just because female athletes are not as popular as male athletes and are not as strong as male athletes, they are still very popular indeed, and this campus really shows that. So obviously, shout out to Iowa basketball. I mean, I've been a huge fan of this school for a while for that. And so I'm going to start off by pointing out the obvious about that situation is that Caitlin Clark, who's actually probably the most well-known NCAA basketball player right now. If you ask anyone on the street, I think they've done polling. She is the most well-known, even above men. She would not be the Caitlin Clark that she is today if she had to compete against men. And I know there's many people who are going to disagree with that, but it is true. And there's a few reasons for that alone. I mean, first, obviously, men are stronger, taller, bigger athletes. In a game of basketball, the ball is actually smaller in women's basketball than it is in men's. And in every single sport you can think of, softball versus baseball, huge difference. Two completely different sports. Volleyball, the net is higher for men. These things show us that there are physical differences between men and women, and not acknowledging that is to not even acknowledge the differences in sports, because these sporting bodies have thought through the different apparatuses they put in these sports, and it is very clear that they are different. So today is a great example of that, and it's actually really cool that I get to be here for that and be on this campus, and I appreciate all of you guys being here instead of watching that game. It really does mean a lot to me. But yes, of course, that's obvious, but thank you so much for being here. Thank you, Jasmine, for that wonderful introduction. And I love YAF. I love doing YAF speeches. It's great to be on campuses, even when there's some people who don't want me here. That's okay. You don't have to like everyone that you see. You don't have to like everything that I say, but I do have a right to say it. And that is something that's very, very important to everyone involved, because even if you're on the opposing side of me, you should want to be able to speak your mind too. And you have that right. So obviously I was a member of the University of Pennsylvania swim team, as it was mentioned in my introduction. And that situation really encompassed what we see on college campuses. And again, I saw a lot of signs prior to my experience on my swim team that college campuses were crazy. For example, I had a professor refer to 9/11 as a cultural misunderstanding because you don't understand Islamic culture, and saying if you don't understand the situation that you're bigoted. I saw everything under the sun. I saw students being failed for their viewpoints, all of it. But it did not come together fully for me to realize how bad it was until I was put on a women's swim team with a man. So it started back in the fall of 2019. I was a sophomore. There was a team meeting, and the men went first and the women went after. And the men finished their meeting and they all go to their locker room, and I noticed there's a member of the men's team that's waiting back. His name was William Thomas. And he just looks at us and says, "I'm transgender and I will be joining your team next year." That was it. There was no other conversation. There was no follow-up on why this was happening. There was no follow-up on what the rules were to allow this to happen. There was no discussion. And everyone who went to our coaches understood that we might have been uncomfortable with it. And so originally they told us that Thomas might be changing in a locker room outside of the one that we all changed in. Because again, it's very uncomfortable for female athletes, especially swimmers, to be changing in locker rooms with men. If you guys don't know anything about swimming, racing suits and swimming take 20 to 30 minutes to get on. You are completely exposed. You sometimes need help pulling your suit on. And it is a very long, prolonged, vulnerable experience where you are completely naked. And to introduce men into that situation is unacceptable. And especially to minors, which is happening across this country, there are young girls who are under the age of 18. Myself and my teammates, obviously we were adults, but there are young girls in this country that are being subjected to this. And that was not even something that we were acknowledging or discussing or bringing any attention to. And so obviously, so we look into the NCAA, and obviously they have this policy that says 1 year of testosterone suppressant allows a male to compete on a women's sports team. And interestingly, the only thing that they acknowledge is testosterone levels, when there are so many other hormones in the human body. There's height differences, there's bone density differences, the size of your hips are different. Women have wider hips than men do, and men have larger lungs, they have larger hearts, and all of these things do not make men better people than women, but they make us physically different. And to not acknowledge that is to not acknowledge how you all got here. Every single person in this room was born from a man and a woman. And if you can't figure out the difference and understand how those two things came together, then you don't understand how you even came to be. And that is something that is going to wreck society if we continue to go down that path. And I know that there's people who disagree with that. I can hear you guys laughing over there. It is true. It is true. And so as this continued, the NCAA did not change their policy, and many people thought that they might. The Ivy League did not change their policy, and many people hoped that they did. And the situation went on, and eventually we lost the season because of COVID, and 2 years later, Thomas was ready to join the women's team. And when we were previously told he would be changing in a different locker room, on the first day, we showed up and he had a locker next to everyone else. And one of my friends, one of my teammates, she was unfortunate enough to have the locker next to him. And my teammate went to our coach and said, "This has to be a joke. I'm not comfortable with this, and I really don't want that to be where my locker is." And our coach said, "I'm really sorry, there's nothing I can do about it." So my teammate then opted to change in the single stall family bathroom outside of the locker room for the entire season. Every single day for practice, she would tiptoe and walk out and change by herself in that locker room and then come back in, because she was so uncomfortable with the idea of undressing next to somebody who had been on the men's team for 3 years and had been changing in the men's locker room. And I watched this happen throughout the season. There were girls who were doing everything they could to avoid undressing with men. At the NCAA championship, there's a girl, Kylie, and she swam for NC State, and she found a janitor's closet with a dirty mop that she chose to change in to avoid undressing next to a man. And she did that because she felt like she had to. She was forced into a situation where she said, I don't want any distractions. I don't want to worry about it. I don't want to feel unsafe. I'm going to do what I can to make myself comfortable. And that's what us girls did the entire season. All the women athletes, whether it be at my school or any school that competed against Thomas, continually we were told our feelings didn't matter and that we had to do what we needed to make ourselves comfortable. And again, this continued. And at first I just thought this is an uncomfortable situation, but we can still talk about it. I could talk to my teammates about it. I could talk to my coach about it. There was some consensus that most people agreed that it wasn't right and it wasn't fair to varying degrees. And we also weren't sure how fast Thomas was actually going to swim, because obviously if it ended up being what ended up happening, an NCAA championship, that is the most extreme outcome of having a man compete with women. So as Thomas started to smash records, break all of our team records, place nationally ranked faster than all Olympians even, this university then came in and told us that Lia being on the team was a non-negotiable. They also told us if we ever spoke out about it, we would regret it and we would spend the rest of our lives wishing that we hadn't. We would never be able to find a job, something else that they told us, and we would spend the rest of our lives being tainted in a bad image for simply speaking about being uncomfortable with competing with men. That was their reasoning, we're never gonna be able to find a job if we just speak the truth. And they continued to push this narrative to us. And in this meeting, they also told us that if we continued to object, they were here to make us comfortable with it. And they provided us psychological services to make us comfortable with the idea of undressing and competing alongside a man. And to me at this point, bringing in psychological services, I thought was a huge step, because it's one thing to tell us not to speak about it. It's one thing to tell us there's nothing we can do about it. But to tell us that we need therapy and we need mental help if we're uncomfortable undressing next to men, that is completely insane, because this is how we feel and you're telling us that our feelings are not valid. You're telling us that our feelings don't matter and us women are the problem and not the people who allowed rules like this to happen, and not the people who want to compete on women's sports teams when they're men. And as the season went on, the university continued to highlight Thomas's achievements by posting everything on social media and ignoring the accomplishments of the other women on the team. We had many athletes on the team who were having great, standout, stellar seasons, and they were all ignored. The university also continued to sell out our sports meets to media. We had tons of press showing up to our meets, taking pictures of us in our swimsuits, which we did not consent to. Nobody wants to be photographed and published all over the news in a swimsuit without being asked. And they continued to do that. And they also sent people from the athletic department to watch over our practices. They sent people from the athletic department to our training trip just to let them know that they are watching us. And this continued. And after the meeting that as the university did more and more to tell us to be quiet, people on my team were less willing to talk about it even amongst ourselves. There were girls before who were very vocal about objecting, and after the athletic department talked to them, they were very quiet and they said, well, there's nothing we can do about it, so we might as well be quiet. And that is never something you should do, because this is how horrible things happen in history. People saying, well, there's nothing I can do about it, I have to stay quiet. Every single historical thing that's ever happened talks about that, how these people were silent and they allow these things to continue. And with that, I did get discouraged, but I gave it kind of one last go. And I was approached by a member of the student newspaper who was a friend of mine. And she said that they were publishing a lot of pieces that were very pro-Lia and they wanted to publish something that was against having men competing in women's sports. And I said, of course, and I got paired up with this editor, and he told me that a lot of my lines were too offensive and would retract them and would change the language, and eventually the piece was so watered down, it was barely what I had originally written, but I was okay with it because I wanted one thing out there that had an opposing viewpoint. That's a huge thing in this country, is that we have free press, and there's a lot of countries in this world that do not have that. And if we don't have that, we don't have a lot of different things. So I was still hopeful, and eventually the piece was published, even though it was completely watered down. And after it was published, it was retracted within 3 hours, and the editor I was working with refused to return my phone calls, and finally, a few weeks later, he admitted to me that the reason it was pulled down was because half the staff threatened to quit over the piece being up because they couldn't stand by something like that on the student newspaper. And so interestingly, the girl who originally approached me to asked me to write this piece, she actually left the newspaper and cited this as being one of the many reasons that she's not, and she actually started her own independent paper. So sometimes you have to go out of the way and do things like that. Great friend of mine, and she's, you know, senior in college now, so I'm really proud of her for doing that. So with all of this, I mean, it was clear at every single stage. It was the administrators wanted us to be quiet. The Ivy League did nothing to help us. The NCAA wanted us quiet. I mean, there's all sorts of things that happen at the actual NCAA championship, which they're now getting sued for, by the way, if that doesn't show how crazy that was. And at every single stage, somebody did something to make us quiet, whether it was sending in administrators, whether it was pulling my op-ed. It was clear that there was no room for discussion. And that's the worst thing about this entire thing, because I understand having different viewpoints on what's fair and what works. I'm okay with that. I'm comfortable with where I am, and I know every single person that you'll ever meet is going to have different opinions on everything. That's just how life is. That's how people work. And if every single person around you has the same viewpoint, you're in a cult. It's time to look around and figure out that you are in a cult if every single person around you believes the same thing. And that goes for us conservatives as well. If you talk to conservatives, when I was in college Republicans, we disagreed on a lot of different things, and it didn't make us hate each other. It didn't make us name call each other. It's just part of reality. It's part of life. And that's how functional societies happen, because you have to debate things. And when you debate things, you become more comfortable either with your own viewpoint, or even better, your mind is changed. And that is what is so important. And I've seen this time and time again, that we're losing track of that. And it's making everybody miserable. It's making people like myself, who feel like I can't speak and I'm being censored, miserable. And it even makes people on the other side miserable too. Whether they realize it or not, to waste their energy name calling and saying all these words, that is not a happy person. And that's what we need to realize, is we need to come back to a place where we can have discussions, where we can listen to people that have opinions that we don't like. And that's just part of life. And so my biggest thing with all of this, I mean, we continue to see throughout the entire experience being college. And after leaving college, I felt incredibly discouraged. I felt as though I had nothing else to say. I felt as if I ever spoke out publicly and formally, that it was going to be the worst thing ever, and I would never have a job, and I would never have friends. And I just, you know, after graduating, I was quiet for a little while. And I saw this story of this girl, Peyton McNabb. She's a high school volleyball player. And she was hit in the head with a ball by a male athlete on the opposing team, and knocked unconscious and paralyzed on one half of her body. And I saw that story, and I was working a normal corporate job, doing what my university wanted me to do. They wanted me to be quiet. They wanted me to go have a normal job and reflect well on what they taught me or whatever. And I saw that story, and I realized, if I continued to be quiet about what I experienced and what's going on across the country, that I was part of the problem, that I was allowing people like Peyton to get injured. And I hear these stories more and more. Actually, there's even a basketball team in Massachusetts where 3 girls on the team were injured by a male athlete on the opposing team, and they had to forfeit the game because they didn't have enough players on the court to be able to play. We have girls, and the other girls who weren't injured, they're not gonna be able to play now too, so they're losing their opportunities as well. This affects so many people across the country, and it's especially scary when it's happening to high school students. Because in the weird way, when this was happening to me, I was able to rationalize it. Because I said, well, I'm an adult. I can handle myself. I know I can get through this. But 17-year-old, 16-year-old girls being permanently injured, Peyton is not able to even play sports in college now, which was a dream of hers. She's now a freshman who's not playing sports. And that was really the moment where I started to realize we have to speak up and we cannot be quiet. And I know that it's difficult, and I won't lie on this journey. I mean, there's been a lot of times where I've even been afraid of saying things. At the beginning, you know, I was afraid of speaking a lot of details about the situation. I just wanted it to be vague, and I wanted to just say, well, I disagree with this, and I'm not going to go into details. And as I've sort of embarked on this journey of speaking out, it's sort of, you know, I'm starting to realize that we have to say everything, and we have to say everything that we want. And I get hate from a lot of different people, and that's okay, because there's much more at stake here than just getting a few hateful messages. We are talking about the destruction of girls' confidence. We're talking about the destruction of reality. We're seeing girls across the country who are discouraged from sports. I was actually just recently connected with a player who plays pickleball, and she told me that there is a man competing in the women's category in pickleball, and that when she goes against him, she's withdrawing. There's lots of girls who are losing the opportunity not just to win trophies, but to compete at all. In my own experience, Thomas being on our team, swimming is a limited roster sport, so every single time Thomas competed, another girl on my team was denied the opportunity to compete at all. And I know for myself, sports did so much for me, and it helped me a lot through my life. It helped me build confidence. It helped me learn time management. It helped me become this person that I am today. And it also helped me get into college. I think that's a big thing, is we're starting to see scholarships for girls be taken away because people are identifying as women and stealing their scholarships. And girls are going to be denied the opportunity to get education. We're also seeing Title IX is potentially about to be rewritten by the Biden administration to say that a woman actually means anyone who believes that they're a woman, and we're going to see people losing opportunities even further. And coaches, on top of that, are going to now be incentivized to recruit male athletes in their sports, and we can't blame them for it, because their job is to have the best team, and they oftentimes get fired if they don't. So if their opposing teams have male athletes in the women's category, how can we expect them to do that? So by these people in leadership, like the NCAA and the Biden administration and all these people, are putting the burden on us to make the right decisions. And oftentimes we can't do that. So that's why we have to be loud, we have to be vocal, and we have to share the truth on this situation. And the truth is that men and women are different. And women have protected sports and protected spaces for a reason. The history of actually the women's bathroom, which I'm starting to learn more about, was actually during the Industrial Revolution, when women started working in factories. And women had to go to the bathroom in groups because there were men who were assaulting them when they were going to the bathrooms. So that actually started to create the push of having these women-only spaces. And the reason for them is not to be discriminatory. It's to provide women with safe places. And women's sports was created after Title IX because these women didn't have a place on sports teams. And it was there to create equal opportunity. That's a big thing, is people talk a lot about gender pay gaps and gender equality and all those words. Having those things is also acknowledging that there are physical differences. This is about equal opportunity, not everyone opportunity. And if we really believe that, then why do we even have women's sports at all? Why do we even have women's bathrooms at all? We might as well get rid of all of those spaces if that's what we believe. So you genuinely believe that we should have one sports team, because that's, okay, that's your opinion, that's great. I'm happy that you think that. But again, there are so many female athletes who are never going to have the opportunity to advance now because of people like that who believe things like that. And that's fine. You know, that's your opinion, and I'm okay with that. But I'm telling you that there are so many different female athletes who will never have the opportunity to experience being a national champion or experience winning their high school meet. I know that when my high school won our state championship for the first time in swimming, it was a huge deal to me. I was 16 years old. We set a record in our relay. We won a bunch of events. Our program had never placed in the top three before. It was a big deal. And to think about losing that opportunity and losing that moment I cherish even 8 years later now is completely disheartening. And honestly, I would never want anyone else to go through that. And again, that's why I do what I do. That's why I speak about these issues, and that's why I'm here to support women. I'm here to support women who want their own spaces, who want equal opportunity, who want sports. And I will not be quiet until this is solved. Something I work on in my day-to-day job is actually passing legislation to help advance women's protections and women's rights. And I would not change it for a day, because as crazy it is that I have to do this, it is very, very important to do this. And again, I want to move on and I want to do different things with my life, but until this is done, I'm going to keep doing it. And I hope that other people are encouraged to also do the same. I mean, it doesn't take being a YAF speaker and going and doing campus speeches. It's about starting at the grassroots level and having day-to-day conversations with people in your life and telling them what you believe and telling them what you think is fair. And so with that, we're going to do some Q&A, obviously, but I really do think that we need to get back to a place where we can talk and we can have conversations. And so don't ever be discouraged, whatever your opinion is. And it's okay. You can change your mind. If you say something wrong, you are allowed to change your mind and say, I've received new information and I was wrong. That is totally allowed. We're gonna move to Q&A, but thank you guys so much again for being here. Excited to be in Iowa. Yeah.
All right, we will now begin our Q&A portion. If you have a question, if you could go on the back and line up by my colleague right there. Please keep it brief and state your name.
Paula, you are a hero, and thank you for all that you do. I played sports too, and I loved volleyball, and I would never play if a man played, because if they spiked me in the face, that'd be the end. And I feel so bad for Paige that she is now disabled. That is a tragedy. So that would move me to do what you did. So I just want to commend you for what you're doing. You're young, but look at you, and thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Hi. In high school, I was a wrestler on an all-male team, so I guess it's kind of backwards there. But at a regional competition, it was all female. There was a man who was competing against another woman and obviously beat her and potentially broke her collarbone and might have dislocated her shoulder in attempt to pin her. My question is, with all the bathrooms and women's sports and locker rooms, why are guys so much more important than us?
I wonder the same thing all the time. Unfortunately, like with anything, people find loopholes, and the women's category is the easier category to compete in. This is not controversial to say. A good example would be at the same NCAA championship that Thomas swam at. There was a girl or a woman who identified as a man still competing in the women's category, right? So if it's so important to compete on the team that matches your identity, why are you still competing with the women? Ask yourself the question. The answer is, it's an easier place to achieve in. And so women's bathrooms are easier access, right? Women are more vulnerable to being assaulted. And so that's why predators are going to prefer being in women's bathrooms. All of those things. And again, this is not to say that every single one of these situations is going to result in someone being victimized. But that is why. And people, bad actors, are always going to take advantage of opportunities like that. And that's why it's so important that we have laws in place and we understand collectively as a society why we're doing this. And the answer is, of course, women should have these protected spaces because we're more vulnerable. I'm really sorry to hear that person was injured. I mean, obviously that is happening more and more, and there are women who are being, again, permanently injured by these athletes. And if that isn't enough to wake people up, I don't know what is. Thank you.
Hi, I'd like to say thank you for coming here, first of all. But my question for you is, after being forced to share a locker room with a man, did you feel like you chose the wrong college?
Yes, absolutely. It's interesting because obviously Riley Gaines is a big speaker on this. She's a very, very close friend of mine. And oftentimes we find ourselves comparing our experiences at her going to a school in the South in SEC, Kentucky, and myself going to a college in the Northeast. She was supported by her athletic department. Her athletic department encouraged her to speak out. Ours told us we needed therapy if we wanted to. And so oftentimes I do think that, you know, again, the Ivy League is this, like, everyone talks about it, everybody wants to go there, but in reality, it's this place that is full of education that's not even teaching you correct things. And that to me is something that obviously, like, I mean, again, I'm sort of thankful that I was there to be able to speak about this stuff and understand the importance, because again, most of my other teammates, they have not spoken about this publicly at all. So for that aspect, I'm thankful, but I do, you know, think about how I wish I had gone to a school that at least at the bare minimum respected my ability to speak about my opinions. Yeah.
You're going to hold it? Thank you for being here and for being part of the discussion. My thought is that if we're going to have a discussion on anything, we have to start with a point of mutual respect. So I would encourage you in the future in referring to Lia or others by the name she chooses rather than the name you give, because I didn't give you a name. It's the name, whatever name you were given at birth, you were given, but you also have a right to change your name. And if that name's been changed legally, or you want to be called whatever you'd like to be called, my respect for you is going to lead me to call you by that name. And I would encourage you to think about that when we visit or talk about any other people.
Hi, I'm just wondering, like, how, you know, you talk a lot about wanting to have conversations and debates, but I'm left wondering how you expect to be able to have those conversations when, like, regardless of the fact that the American Medical Association and the American Psychological Association and, you know, dozens of other licensing boards across the country and the world all acknowledge that being transgender is normal and fine. How do you expect to have good faith conversations when you won't acknowledge that trans women are women, even though medical associations across the world will, and people who have degrees in medicine?
So funny you say that, actually. There are a lot of countries across the world that are actually pulling back on transgender medications. No, it's true. France, Switzerland, a lot of countries in Europe have. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very interesting point that you say that, because there have been time and time again that the medical industry has made mistakes. Have we seen the opioid crisis, where people were abused and victimized by big pharma and medical industries? It's happened, and I think we need to have a serious conversation about how these people are being turned into patients for lives. We need to talk about how people are profiting hundreds and thousands of dollars per patient on people who are being told that if they just take some hormones and get some surgeries, that all their happiness will be back. This is not something that I take lightly. We are talking about young children who are being victimized by the medical industry, and if we're going to talk about that, we need to talk about these young kids who are being convinced that the best way to solve their problems is to become a patient in big pharma for life. And again, we've seen it time and time again. The opioid crisis has victimized people, and this is just another example of that.
Trans women are women, or are you not willing to go there?
They're not. They were born men.
Oh yeah, I could ask another brief question. So if you want to reach across the aisle or, you know, talk to people who disagree with you, how do you expect to do that when you won't acknowledge that they are humans who are the gender that they have transitioned to be? How do you expect to have this conversation if you won't say that trans women are women?
I'll give you this. I believe that some trans women believe that they're women, but that doesn't actually make it true. I know kids that... I know kids to think they're dinosaurs or dogs or cats, and that doesn't make it true. Just because you believe something doesn't mean that it's true. And the nice thing to do is to be honest and have a conversation and help these people who are feeling that way and understand why they're feeling like they reject the body that God gave them.
Hey there. I just first wanted to say thank you so much for coming and speaking about this, because I'm a student athlete here on the track team, and I know for a fact that if we didn't have separate men's and women's track and fields teams, I wouldn't be on the team, I wouldn't have a scholarship, I wouldn't be here. And I came to Iowa for track, so if we didn't have that, my life would be completely different. My question is, so being on the track and field team when we travel to meets, we are in hotel rooms with, paired up with another, me with another woman, and men get paired with men. So I'm wondering if that was similar for you on the swim team and how that worked with Lia Thomas.
Yeah, I've actually never been asked that before. First, thank you for being a student athlete that's here. I know a lot of athletes get scared by this topic. So interestingly, when we would go to travel, girls would immediately be waiting in line for a coach when rooming assignments would come out, and he would say, I know why you're here. You're trying to see how I'm making the rooms. So my coach actually purposely roomed Thomas with one girl on the team who was comfortable with rooming with him, and no one else was subjected to that, which shows you that they acknowledge that we have these feelings, and they acknowledge that nobody wants to room with somebody of the opposite sex. And so our coach was actually nice enough to do that for us, which was really great, because again, come to every single meet or every time we would travel for something, people would get really anxious about the idea of sharing a room with a man. So luckily that was never an issue for myself or any of my teammates who did feel that way. So yeah.
Hi, I have two questions real quick. So the first one, you mentioned it a little bit during your talk, but when it comes to women versus men in sports, do you honestly believe that women are inferior to men biologically?
Yes, I do. And it's not to say that a woman couldn't beat a man athlete, because it can happen, but we are talking about physiological differences, okay? On average, men are taller, stronger, they have larger bones, they have bigger hearts, they have bigger lungs, and in a sport like swimming, the size of their hips. Men have narrower hips than women do. And that actually makes you go faster if you just push off the wall. And again, just because a woman can beat a man in some sport, there's some men I bet I can beat in swimming. It doesn't overcome the fact that we have to train harder to be there. Even my father, who is in his 60s, can beat me in some swimming races, and he swam in high school. It's because he has a body that is different that allows him to do those things. And it doesn't make me a bad athlete. It doesn't make me a bad woman. It's just reality. And again, equal opportunity is to have equal opportunity for both people. And that means having women-only sports.
Thank you for clarifying that. My second question, you mentioned anti-trans legislation. What do you have to say about the increase in suicide rates amongst teens and adults after this passing of anti-trans legislation?
So it's interesting that you say anti-trans legislation, because I actually never said that. I'm talking about pro-women legislation. So, right, the fact that we want protected sports teams, the fact that we want women's prisons are now being invaded by people who identify as women that have male parts and are assaulting women prisoners or getting pregnant in prisons. And in California, they're putting condom dispensers in prisons. Having intercourse, sexual intercourse in prison is illegal, and they're encouraging that. And they're saying, well, if you're gonna rape somebody, do it safely. And so with that, I say that this is a legislation that is pro-women, and for you to label it as anti-trans is disingenuous, because a lot of this legislation does not mention the word trans people whatsoever at all. And again, the work that I do, it's not stopping anyone from putting in legislation if they want to protect trans people or whatever they believe it might be. It is about defining womanhood and defining women-based terms and sex-based terms to mean what they were intended to mean, which we had a really hard time figuring out the last couple of years because everyone's turned it upside down.
it seems like there's two different issues, and it's really interesting that there's the question of should trans women be in women's sports and trans men in men's sports, but also even if you do have them together, the bathrooms and the changing rooms and the hotel rooms, I think that even if you can't segregate the trans people from the cis people in the sports, like, you're onto something, because we can't change everyone's minds to be comfortable with changing in front of like someone of the opposite sex. And I, even in PE, I was super uncomfortable with changing in front of cis women too. So I'm like wondering, could there be a solution of like changing rooms that are separate, and like, is there something we could do to fight for this? Because it could help a lot of different people, like whether there's trans people there or not. Like, that was one of your big issues. So yeah, I wonder what you think of that as like, I know it's not the full solution you want, but if we can't, if you can't convince the organizations to segregate the sports to get like amenities so that you can change by yourself or change not with everyone else. I wonder what you think, and what we could do, like petitions or something, like is there room to change these things?
Yeah, again, I'm open to compromises. That's something a lot of people talk about, and the biggest issue with that, right? So if you wanted to just build every single bathroom, be single stall, that's a lot of money, and there's a lot of facilities across the country. And unfortunately, money talks. There's not buttloads of money, excuse, like for lack of a better word, to be doing something like that. And so again, if we wanted to try to do it, of course we can start petitions, but unfortunately a lot of organizations will not have the money for that. And I've heard that presented by a lot of other people on both sides of the aisle. I do think it would work, but we have to be realistic, and I don't think the funding is there for that. So maybe we start group fundraising. Maybe that's the call to action on that.
Just, thank you.
Hello. Thank you for your talk. I want to phrase this as a question, because what made me decide to come up and pose a question to you was the individual who started citing a number of organizations, medical organizations, and a previous person asked you about your experience in college. And when I was in college, I remember we were taught to not just take things on authority, such as, you know, 4 out of 5 dentists recommend a certain chewing gum, say, for example, or a medical association. An association delivers a particular. I guess I'm wondering, how has this experience helped you to develop your critical thinking when people make broad sweeping claims about whether say the statement of a particular organization is probative of the assertion that they're making, or is that simply an example of the logical fallacy of an appeal to authority, where you know the example comes to, again, to that commercial that 4 out of 5 dentists recommend a certain chewing gum, therefore what? And so I guess, that's what I learned in college, is how to be a critical thinker and how to learn how to, like, just because, I'll leave it at that. I hope you, has this helped you, this experience of having to, you've had to really, some of the claims on the transgender side are very emotionally charged, and they sort of presume a great deal of they're very emotionally charged. And to address those, you have to engage in a certain analysis. You have to be able to critically examine claims about cause and effect. That's another thing you learn about cause and effect. So what have you learned about those things? I guess I'm trying to
ask. Okay. Yeah, yeah. So I actually studied computer science in engineering school undergrad. So I think a lot of this, I've already had these skills in sort of like taking something and looking into why it happened. So the biggest thing, like when it was first announced to me that Thomas was going to be competing on our team, I said, you know, okay, what is the policy that allows this? And so I actually dug into the NCAA's policy and I said, okay, why do they believe for some reason that 1 year testosterone suppressant is enough to make a man equivalent to a woman on a sports team? And I actually found that there wasn't a lot of scientific research for it, that what you were saying, all that was there was just anecdotes about people being happier being on the team, so it must be fair. And I'm starting to see this, not just in this space, but in everything, is that there's been a huge change in the media, and people are reading things and not fact-checking anything at all. And this is on both sides, right? For example, actually this morning on my way here, somebody saw, like, had made this headline saying, like, the Paris Olympics had formally banned Lia. Like, they've never come out and formally said that, so people are just kind of taking something, running with it, and nobody's fact-checking. And so, to all people, I encourage you to, when you see something, read about it. And even if you agree with it, say, okay, let's make sure that this is actually correct. And I'm seeing a huge decline in that, and also in academia. They're not encouraging people to do this research. And it's starting from the college campuses, so again, I've definitely started to learn to not take things at face value, to dig deeper, to ask questions. I think that's the biggest thing, is to ask questions. And that's something I've done. And again, I'm still learning. There's still things that I see that I don't know everything about. But it's about having that desire and looking into it and digging. And I encourage more students to do that.
I can hold the mic. I've held a lot of mic. Why? Okay, this is fucking ridiculous. Hello. I'm not allowed to hold the mic. Sorry, this is ridiculous. Okay, Paula, I'm honestly having a little trouble following your point, because it seemed at first like you were talking about being scared in the bathroom. Did Lia ever hurt or attack any of the teammates in the bathroom?
No, but it doesn't change the fact that. Do you have a further question?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that was a question. I'm sorry.
No, the answer was no. Lia didn't ever hurt anybody in the bathroom, correct?
Yeah, but there's further to why I feel uncomfortable. But if you don't want to listen, that's on you.
And any of your other teammates, have they been speaking publicly about this, or they are just too scared to talk, like you were saying?
Some have, very limitedly, though.
So is your issue that you don't want trans women in women's sports, or is your issue that you don't want trans women to exist? What is your issue exactly? Because none of us are able to follow the point that you're trying to make here.
I'm pretty sure people can, but my point is sports teams, bathrooms, women's spaces, prisons. I think that people who are born male should not be in those spaces if they're designated for women.
I'm a swimmer. I swim 3 or 4 times a week. I go to the rec center. There's not a space for me to change. That's fine. There are other people that go into the rec center, and if they have an issue with somebody that's in the changing area, they go to the designated area to change. It sounds like that solution was available to everyone that was in your team. And yet, you're making a worldwide lecture tour about having been inconvenienced in this way by Lia. Maybe you could join Lia in attending law school, and you can have a debate in a courtroom in the future, and so that you could actually talk about what the problem is that you have, which is that you don't believe that trans women are women, and they f***ing are.
Well, why are they trying to make women's sport a retirement plan for failed male athletes? Because I've got a 12-year-old granddaughter, that I don't want to have to go through what you did, and I'm glad you're trying to enlighten people on what's out there. And maybe I shouldn't say this, but I've talked with a lot of people. I think there's three genders: the male, the female, and the confused. And I wouldn't want a woman coming into my bathroom. I'm private, you know. I can't imagine a girl wanting to have a male with or a female with male genitals coming in. I mean, I'd be scared to death. So, I mean, why is the NCAA and why are the professors and all that backing this stuff up when you need the opportunity, and my granddaughter needs the opportunity to have a scholarship, maybe to go to college, you know?
Thank you. Thank you for your stance on that. I don't know why these organizations are quiet. I think a lot of them are afraid. They're afraid of upsetting people, but unfortunately, there is reality and there's truth in male and female, and if people want to deny that, that's to deny reality and deny biology and things that we all used to agree upon 15 years ago. So I do appreciate it, and I'm doing this for, again, people like your granddaughter to make sure they never have to go through what I did and what other women across this country are experiencing.
Hi, Paula. I just had a couple words of encouragement for you. I thank you for coming here and sharing this message of the truth that there are two genders, male and female, and that ultimately the worldview you are promoting is the one that was created by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But there are two guys and two girls, and to deny that is of Satan. And yeah, thank you for coming and sharing that message of truth. And know at the end of the day, Jesus Christ does win. We do win at the end of the day. Wickedness will not prevail. It will perish in hell with Satan forever. Thank you for the message you're sharing. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Hi, I kind of have like an opinion, but first of all, I want to say thank you for coming out here. I think it's really, I just admire your encouragement and your bravery for coming out here, like especially in a generation or like a whole community that gets pissed off really fast when you disagree. I really like your opinion. I really honestly think that America is really based on debating. Like, not everybody agrees with each other, but I feel like when you share opinions and you can agree and disagree without flipping out, I feel like it's really important. So I want to thank you for coming up tonight. And an opinion I want to ask you is, what's your opinion on like the hormones that are brought to children and the whole community that's brought to children, like what they call drag queens in libraries? I've seen that a lot more recently. And I feel like it's really, really becoming a problem, especially towards like little children. Like, I have three little siblings, two little brothers and a little sister. And I don't know what I would do if she turned out to be like that. So I just want to know what your opinion is on how we could try to fight that. And how can we prevent it? I think it's just really wrong.
Yeah, so it's really interesting that you bring that up. I have a lot of like family friends and people in my life who have never voted before, and they have school-aged children, and they're starting to see what's happening in their classrooms. They're starting to see their kids being indoctrinated and forced to participate in things them as parents don't consent to. There's a huge fight sort of against parental control here. We're seeing actually, there's a story where both parents actually disagreed with their kid transitioning, and the government actually took the kid away from them. So we're actually seeing it, and the bigger attack is right on these parental rights. There's parents who don't want their kids to be exposed to certain things. And it's really hard, but again, the biggest thing is to get out there when you see things, say something, to go out and vote. And again, that's actually one of the biggest things I'm seeing. And right, I have these people in my life who have young children, and they've never voted before, and now they have this strong desire to get out and vote because they're seeing what's happened to their children. They're seeing what's happened on their schools and on their school trips. I know parents who don't want to allow their kids to go on an unsupervised school trip with the teachers because they don't know what the teachers are teaching them and what the other students that they might be rooming with are. So that's sort of the biggest thing, and just get out, be active, and you know, be in tune with your community. Let your local representatives know. There's always things you can do, and there's always ways you can take action, and just continue to build own your community, to have conversations, and to make the changes that you want.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Emily, and I thank you for sharing your opinion. I'd also like to start with, I'm no conservative. I love poor people, gay people, minorities, everyone, transgender people. But I'm also, I'm a retired competitive boxer. And USA Boxing recently came out with a transgender policy that is absolutely horrible. They allow you to transition, if you transition, you cannot compete in any division for 4 years until you get your quarterly hormone testing. So one, they're excluding you right as soon as you transition. And if so, even if you wanted, if you were a biological male and you wanted to still compete against males, they don't allow that. As a female, I sparred with men. I absolutely know there's a difference, and it would not be fair to let a biological male compete against a female. I believe there's a way to include everybody, though, and I support like a third division, like an open division, where anyone can opt into and where transgender people can be included, because I do think they need a space, but I definitely think it's not fair for biological females to compete against biological men. And I wanted to know your thoughts about that type of solution.
Thank you for sharing your opinion and for asking the question. I do think if we want to have a third category, we're welcome to, but in times we've seen it become either no one enters or all of the winners in that category are male. And people are very upset by that. Also, there's been talks about in sports where there's prize money that they have to divide the prize money by three now instead of by two. And again, if there's a way to make it work, I would love that. I've just seen a lot of failures on it. An alternative I often throw out there is we can make the men's category open and women's category is protected. I'm open to that. People still object to that, but that is something I've proposed and I've continued to propose as well. So that is something I believe in. Again, nobody should be banned from sports. We just have to do it in sex-based categories.
So I'm still wondering, like, how, you know, for example, if somebody is testing, you know, hormone levels for athletes, how would you respond to the fact that there have been cisgender women who have had testosterone levels that are too high based on these hormonal tests to compete in women's sports, even though they were born cisgender women?
Again, honestly, I don't necessarily agree with all of those bans because, again, like I've been saying, there's a lot of hormones in the human body. There's a lot of factors that make people different athletes. The reason that they test for the testosterone is because if you take human growth hormone and you cheat, that will spike your levels. And so oftentimes they do need to do a further investigation into why this person's levels are so high. And if it's done so naturally, oftentimes it'll be appealed, but there are many cases where people have been caught doping. I know that the back in the day, the Russian Olympians had high levels of testosterone, and the women on the American team who had to compete against them said it was incredibly unfair. And so they put in these tests to try to create fair competition. And again, people are cheating in both the men's and the women's categories, so that's why we have these tests. And that is the biggest tell when someone is cheating, is their testosterone levels are going to be higher. So they have to investigate that, or we can't have fair sport.
I have one quick follow-up. So I just have a quick follow-up question because I want to make sure all the journalists in the room can get this. So you've already said that you don't believe that trans women are women. Do you have any scientific evidence to back that up, or is that based solely on your religious personal belief? And can you cite those sources if you have them? Because, you know, like I'm in a master's program and I read a lot of research papers and I haven't seen anything other than religious arguments.
Yeah, I'm really serious.
Have you ever heard of an X chromosome and an XY chromosome? Because that's the scientific basis.
Intersex people exist. Intersex births are just as frequent as twin births. You're more likely to have an intersex child than a redhead. How do you explain people who have two X chromosomes and one Y chromosome?
So when you have a Y chromosome, that condition is actually presents as male. So as soon as you have a Y chromosome that's active, and as soon as you have a Y chromosome that's active and the aspects of the Y chromosome are activated, you are male. You become male. I can find it. I mean, I can find it online.
Great. I would love to give you my email so you could send that to me. Or if you'd be more comfortable, like, I could just email you and follow up. I just want to know how to contact you.
You can contact the YAF people and we can figure it out.
Okay, great. So what's your email?
I'm.
Okay, is there like a yeah email?
After the show question, next one.
Okay, maybe like some business cards or something would be great. Do you have a yeah business card by chance? No?
Hi. I once again have two questions for you. The first one, it's become relevant as of what people are saying. Do you believe in the separation of church and state as written out in our U.S. Constitution?
Yes, I don't understand why you're asking that.
It just seems to me that this religious rhetoric has been, come into this conversation when that is not what we're talking about at all. And I just wanted to make sure that that is true to your beliefs. My second question is actually my question from before that you didn't answer. What do you have to say about the rising suicide rates in trans teens and adults as a direct, excuse me, as a direct cause from these anti-trans legislation, such as not allowing hormone therapy or gender replacement therapy and, surgery?
So studies have shown that people are actually, 10 years after transition, they're actually more suicidal than, I can pull them up, I can go find them. Okay, that study, one of the 1% rates, they had 4 people respond, so it's of 4 people. Okay, I'm answering a question. If you would like to come up and answer questions, you are more than welcome to at your own time. I feel unfortunate there are people who feel suicidal. I've actually lost several friends to suicide before. It's something I would never wish upon anyone. And in fact, actually one of my really close childhood friends lost his life to suicide. Not something I take very seriously. Anyone going through that, I feel bad for them. And I wish nothing but the best for them. And I would never want anyone to take their own life. But to think that the solution to causing people to not commit suicide is to inject themselves into unnatural hormones and to get surgeries that are experimental at best is not the solution. And I want to support everyone in being happy and being healthy and being themselves, of course, because who wouldn't have that belief? But to think that you need to do it by medicalizing yourself and taking drugs is not the way that it's done. And again, people have been continuing to commit suicide even after transition, so we need to examine this entire industry and say, why is this still happening if that's the solution?
All right, this will be the last question of the night.
I have a daughter who's Chloe Cole's age, and her parents were bullied into data that wasn't true. I encourage all of you on the other side to do your research. Oh, there's more suicides for males who have had their parts cut off and then realized that it doesn't work like a woman's. I've watched many videos of these poor people.
That's actually really disingenuous for you to be laughing when this woman is trying to share her experience. So if you could just let her finish the question, we would appreciate
it's
that.
It's disrespectful and censorship, but that's okay. I'm not doing that to them. But that's the problem, is when you're so close-minded that you don't want to listen and do your own research and do the critical thinking, you end up being a victim. And we're loving enough to let you know, do your research before you take this other information. So, you know, I say that in a loving way. I want everyone to be happy and healthy. And I want to know if you've done your research on how you make an XX and XY. Yeah. Your hormone levels might change, but how do you change XX to XY? Why don't you research that?
Thank you.
That'll conclude the event. Thank you all for coming out tonight.
Let's give one more round of applause to the amazing Paula Scanlan.